Now let's talk about how we can find corners in an image. But first let's describe what we mean by a corner. A corner is essentially a point where two edges meet. So unlike an edge where you have rapid change in image intensity in one direction, in this case, if you place a window around a corner, you're going to get rapid change in image intensity in two directions. And that's what's being illustrated here. So here you're showing fairly large regions, and here you see a flat region, an edge region, and a corner region. In this case, you have more or less constant brightness, barring, of course, the noise in the image. In this case, you have a high brightness value and a low brightness value, but a clear edge in the middle. And in the case of a corner, you have again a large brightness value and a low brightness value, but you have now two edges that come to meet at the center pixel. And so when you apply your corner detector to this pixel, you want to be able to declare it as being a corner. Now, as in the case of edge detection, we are going to use the derivatives of the image to actually perform corner detection. So here you see the three regions once again, and we're going to find the derivative of the image with respect to the x direction, that's ix, and the derivative with respect to the y direction. And these are the results that you see for the three regions right here. In each case, we're going to normalize the output so that white, which is the largest value in the image, corresponds to a strong positive value, black is a strong negative value, and gray corresponds to a low value or zero. So here you see that you get gray all over the place, and that's because you have low gradient in X and in Y, barring, of course, the gradients that you get because of the noise. And in this case, you get, again, low gradients on both sides of the edge, but very strong positive gradient in the X direction along the edge or close to the edge, and the same in the case of the Y gradient right here. In the case of the corner, you see something interesting. You get low values pretty much everywhere, except you get positive, strong positive value along this edge for Ix, strong negative value along this edge, strong negative value along this edge for Iy, and strong positive value along this edge. So now we are going to classify these three regions. We're going to call them flat, edge, or corner based on the distribution of gradients within these regions. So we're going to go into gradient space. We can define the space Ix, Iy, take all the gradients in the previous slide, and then map them to this space. And when you do that for the flat region, you get, of course, a very compact, not surprisingly, compact cluster close to the origin, because all the gradients that you've computed are pretty small values. When you look at the edge region, you once again get a compact cluster because there's a lot of flat region on both sides of the edge, but you also get this very long linear cluster right here. And that corresponds, this cluster that you're looking at here, corresponds to the large Ix, Iy values that you get at or close to the edge. So that's not surprising. In the case of the corner, you again get your compact cluster because of the flat regions, both in the dark area and the bright area, but you get these two additional clusters here. If you look at this cluster right here, that has very large Ix values, and that comes from this edge right here, low Iy values. And then this one has, this cluster right here, has large Iy values, and that's because of this edge right here, while it has low Ix values. So essentially the key idea here is that we want to somehow quantify this structure. We want to be able to describe it with a small number of parameters, the structure of the distribution. Once we do that, the hope is that we can use those parameters to then categorize or classify the region as being flat, edge, or corner. So the way we do that is by taking the distribution and fitting an ellipse to the distribution. So the ellipse is going to be centered at the origin. And once you've been able to do this, and we'll see how we do this, you're going to end up with a semi-major axis for the ellipse, which is lambda 1, and a semi-minor axis for the ellipse, which is lambda 2. And based on just lambda 1 and lambda 2, we are going to then classify the region. So how do we actually fit an ellipse to a distribution? Well, this takes us back to our lecture on binary images. We know how to do this. Here is a binary image, a binary object, if you will. And we know how to find the axis of least second moment, which is also the axis of minimum moment of inertia. That's this one right here. And we also know how to find that moment, the moment about this axis, which is E-min, minimum second moment. And perpendicular to this axis is another axis, which is the axis of maximum second moment or maximum moment of inertia. And we also know how to find the maximum second moment, which is Emax. What we're going to do is essentially say that the length of the semi-major axis of the ellipse that we want to represent this object by, that's lambda 1, is simply equal to Emax. And the length of the semi-minor axis, lambda 2, is going to be E-min. That's it. So now we want to apply the same technique to our distribution. In other words, we are going to treat our distribution like a binary object. So how do we do that? We can just simply assume that this is a binary image where each dot there is, each point there is a 1. And so while it's not a fully connected contiguous binary object, it doesn't really matter. We can still treat it like points in a binary image. And that's exactly what we do. We use these points to compute the second moment A, B, and C, where A and C are the second moments with respect to the y-axis and the x-axis, and B is, we know it's called the product moment right here. So we compute these three numbers, and we know from our previous discussion about binary objects that from these three numbers, we can compute the maximum moment, second moment, and the minimum second moment. And those correspond to your semi-major axes and the semi-minor axes, and you're done. So let's take a look at how this works out in our example that we've been looking at with these three regions, flat, edge, and corner. In this case, as expected, you're going to get small values for lambda 1 and lambda 2 because it's a compact cluster, right? And when that's the case, we can say it's a flat region. In the case of an edge, you're going to get a very large value for lambda 1 and a very small value for lambda 2. That would be an edge. In the case of a corner, you're going to get large values for both lambda 1 and lambda 2. So our job is now pretty simple. We're going to classify the region simply based on lambda 1 and lambda 2. So you can think about this whole problem in lambda 1, lambda 2 space. If you happen to be a point close to the origin in this space, you essentially are a flat region. And if you happen to lie in this region, where lambda 1 is much greater than lambda 2, it's an edge. If you're in the blue region, where both are significant, then you might call it a corner. So we want to come up with a very simple way of doing this classification, and that's what the Harris corner detector does. Essentially, what Harris has done is come up with an expression here where he maps lambda 1 and lambda 2 to a single number r. So this is an empirically determined function, lambda 1 times lambda 2 minus k times lambda 1 plus lambda 2 squared, where k is also empirically determined. When you plug in lambda 1 and lambda 2 here, you get r, and r is being plotted here in this image, where the brightness of the point is proportional to r. So what's nice about this space is that if you now use a threshold, you apply a threshold to R, each threshold corresponds to this kind of a curve in lambda 1, lambda 2 space. And so you can say if you happen to be in this region, that is R is above the threshold, you're likely a corner. If you're below the threshold, then you're not a corner. So it's that simple. So let's see how this works. So here you have a very simple image, admittedly, BBC. And you apply Harris corner detection to it. And this is the value of R that you're looking at on this side. So the R goes from dark values. So black represents very low values of R. White is large values, and you're going through shades of red and yellow. And you see that essentially at the corners, you see very large values right here. Now, one of the problems with corner detection, and this happens with feature detection in general, is that when you look at the corners, at the points where you have these strong responses, you're going to get clusters of points that have large values, and you need to decide which one is the peak. So this is quite natural. So in this case, you get all of these very bright values, and that's because you're very close to a corner. So that says that we really need to find the peaks, and the peaks would then correspond to the corners. This again is a problem that appears in many different domains. It's peak detection. And the method we're going to talk about now is useful in all of those different domains, and that's called non-maximal suppression. So the idea is extremely simple. It is to take a little window, and you're going to slide this window over the image. In this case, the image is the image R, which is the response to the corner detector. And at each position, if the pixel at the center is the maximum value, then you simply retain it. If it's not the maximum value, which means there's some other pixel in that tiny window that actually has a larger value, then you either suppress it, you diminish the value, or you essentially eliminate it completely. So that's how this works. So in this case, this point is clearly not a peak. This point is not a peak because this point is brighter, so you might just eliminate it or you might suppress it. And this one happens to be a peak. So this way you can find the peak with one scan of the image. All right, so once you've done with that, then you end up with your corners. And here are the corners overlaid on the image that you started off with, BVC. And you see that more or less, the corners are in all the right places. You do say some things, some corners right here detected, which may or may not be deemed as corners, although they have very high curvature here. But otherwise, you get good results. But admittedly, this is a very simple image. So let's take a look at something a little bit more challenging. This is a printed circuit board, and you have lots of corners in this case. And once again, you have your R image, which is computed using the technique we described. This is after thresholding the R image, and then after applying peak detection using non-maximal suppression, you get these corners right here. If you take a close look at these, you see that we've done pretty well. There are a couple of corners, like this one right here that's missed, and maybe this one right here, but by and large, the corners have been detected quite well. Now, since we're talking about corners, let's end with an illusion that's related to corners. So this has more to do with us, the human visual system. So here you see an image, a checkerboard-like pattern, but when you look at it, you see that the center of the pattern actually bulges in this area right here. And you see that the pattern has a lot of these tiny little dots or squares, white dots and black dots that are placed strategically close to the corners of your checkerboard pattern. And if you remove these tiny little squares, you see that indeed you have a perfect checkerboard pattern. All the lines are either parallel or perpendicular to each other. If you introduce the squares, the tiny little squares back, you see the bulge once again. So this is interesting. It turns out that by placing these tiny squares close to the intersections in the main checkerboard pattern, you're actually biasing the human visual system to believe that the corners are at slightly different locations than they actually are. These are some of the biases that are inherent to the human visual system that leads us to this conclusion that there's a bulging happening in the center of the image. Once again, the punchline is we're not perfect.